inform you past BFS transfer prep, please?
Challenger Houston with a KSC altimeter update.
Houston, go ahead.
Roger, your new forecast altimeter for RTLS would be 30.32, and that's the only weather update we have for you.
30.32, okay, thanks, Nick.
Roger.
LTD, launch director. Guidelines director. Okay, we have a go on RTLN weather. Copy. Thank you.
CDROTC.
CDRO.
On CRT3, can you verify no asterisk by item 25?
That's verified. No asterisk by item 25.
Copy that. DTS?
DTS, copy. The launch window for today's launch is currently 120 minutes. Therefore, we do have a time for a second attempt. TLT, please do not start the APU start until command by OTC at T-minus 5 minutes.
TLT.
Okay, if for any reason a cutoff is requested, the LTD will say GLS give cutoff. APU hold time is 7 minutes, lock drain back time is 20 minutes, and as I stated, 7 minutes, and the launch window is 120 minutes. All personnel not active in terminal count will monitor channel 217. At this time, firing 3 is closed off, and there will be no ingress or egress until the tower clear. Go ahead, Houston flight. SPE. Copy, Houston flight's comment. Able to drain back full time should be 5.5 minutes instead of 7 minutes.
Good afternoon. I'd like to introduce to you the commander of STS-51L, Commander Dick Scobee, who will introduce the rest of his crew, and they'll say a few words.
Thank you. Our fans are over here in the corner. As usual, it's a real pleasure to be at the Cape, to come down here and participate in something that the Cape does better than anybody in the world, and that's launching space vehicles. It's a great pleasure for us to be here. We expect weather like this on Sunday when we launch, and you all do the best to keep it that way if you would. And what I'll do is introduce the next crew member, and we'll just go down the line, let everybody say a little bit as we go. And I'd like to introduce my pilot, Mike Smith, who's one of the best flyers in the world, and he's great to have in the shuttle, and I'm glad to have him aboard as a pilot. So here's Mike.
Thanks, Dick. Let me echo what Dick said about it's good to be down here and to be flying a vehicle that we know a lot of folks down here have worked very hard on. We understand it's ready to go, and we're looking forward to going to fly. I'm one of the three people on board who's and it'll be my first time to fly. Christa McCauliffe and Greg Jarvis, it'll also be their first time, and we're just all looking forward to getting on orbit and getting the secret handshake. I'd like to introduce now Judy Resnick. She's our center seater, and I keep Dick and I honest on the system problems. Judy.
Well, I too am glad to be here one more time, and I am hoping that the affliction that Steve Hawley had from the 41D mission specialist of the delays hasn't rubbed off on me, and I think the guys behind me are hoping that it hasn't also. Otherwise, they might throw me off the flight. And I will now introduce El Onizuka.
Let me say that it's really a pleasure to be back. I'm looking forward to going to fly this one. I think we got some real interesting payloads. The mission is a great mission. We're looking forward to it, and I think we're ready to go fly. Thanks for being out here today. I forgot the one thing I was supposed to do. Let me introduce Ron McNair, who is going to be doing a lot of work with the Spartan Halley mission and carrying on a lot of the experiments that will be going on in the crew compartment.
Again, I'd like to echo the opinions of my crew members that we look forward to returning, launching from the Cape, first of all, and returning here a few days later. I had the privilege of being a part of the crew a couple of years ago that made the first landing here at the Cape, and I intend to be a part of the crew to make the first return landing to the Cape in about a week. At this time, I'd like to introduce you or to perhaps the person you came to see, and that's Christa McCauliffe, our payload specialist, teacher in space.
Well, I am so excited to be here. We watched Columbia go over the Houston area this morning, and that was a thrill. I don't think any teacher has ever been more ready to have two lessons in my life. I've been preparing these since September, and I just hope everybody tunes in on day four now to watch the teacher teaching from space. I'd like to introduce to you someone who's going to be in my second lesson, Greg Jarvis, the payload specialist from Hughes.
It's a great pleasure finally to get this far. I'm very proud to be part of the program that NASA and Hughes have put together, and I'm glad to be representing the Hughes Aircraft Company as their payload specialist. Without any further ado, I'll get off the stage so you can all get going. Thank you very much.
An announcement on NASA Select Television shows that the Teacher in Space Project's Mission Watch reports will resume with Barbara Morgan, who is the backup teacher observer, on Wednesday, January 29th at 10:30 a.m. Central Standard Time. That's 11:30 a.m. Eastern Time and 8:30 a.m. Pacific Time.
And then we have Commander Dick Scobee sitting beside Pilot Mike Smith in front of the traditional cake featuring Halley's Comet and an apple for the teacher. Judy Resnick on the left, mission specialist, along with Ron McNair and payload specialist Greg Jarvis, all members of the 51L crew. And they're going to give it another shot today. There they are, the crew of Mission 51L. Including teacher in space participant and the first private citizen to fly in space, Christa McCauliffe. This is shuttle launch control at T-2 hours, 28 minutes and counting. Here comes the 51L flight crew boarding the elevator for the second time in 2 days, ready to depart the ONC building for the launch pad. And here comes the flight crew now. Commander Dick Scobee, followed by Mission Specialist Judy Resnick, Ron McNair, and Pilot Mike Smith, followed by Christa McCauliffe, teacher in space, Ellison Onizuka, and Payload Specialist Greg Jarvis. Big smiles today. Confidently getting into the van. They're going to go out to that pad and attempt a second try. Second try at launch today. It'll take a few minutes for the astronaut van to get to the pad.
And the first crew member, Commander Dick Scobee, now in the white room, taking off his jacket. Along with Mike Smith, who is the pilot. Dick Scobee became a military pilot and later a test pilot the hard way. He enlisted in the Air Force in 1957 and was trained as a reciprocating engine mechanic. However, he went to night school during the time he was down at Kelly Air Force Base and earned 2 years of college credit, which helped lead to his selection as for the Airman's Education and Commissioning Program. He graduated from the University of Arizona with a degree in aerospace engineering, received his commission in 1965 and his wings in 1966. He's completed a number of assignments for the Air Force, including becoming an Air Force test pilot. He was the pilot of the 41C mission, which deployed the Long Duration Exposure Facility, which is still in orbit, and captured and repaired the Solar Maximum mission satellite and placed it in orbit where it is functioning better than ever. Mike Smith putting on his egress harness, too. They're going to be going very fast today to get out of the cold and into the cabin. Mike Smith is one of the few rookies on board this flight. He's a graduate of the U.S. Naval Academy in Annapolis and received his naval aviator wings in 1969. He had a 2-year tour of duty in Vietnam and is a graduate of the Navy Test Pilot School, where he also served as an instructor for 18 months. Altogether, he's flown about 28 different types of civilian and military aircraft, logging over 4,300 hours. He's taken on a number of tasks while he's been in the Astronaut Corps. He served as commander in the Shuttle Avionics Integration Laboratory in Houston, which tests all of the instrumentation and computers and software for the shuttle. He also was deputy chief of aircraft operations and technical assistant to the director of flight operations, George Abbey. He also served in the Astronaut Office Development and Test Group. After the scrub yesterday, the crew went back to the crew quarters, where they relaxed for a while and were able to have dinner with their spouses in the crew quarters dining room. But they had to be in bed by about 7 o'clock so they could be up and on their way this morning. Mike Smith shaking hands with the closeout crew, which has assisted him in getting ready. They take a look at his feet and wipe those out to make sure he's not carrying any debris into the cabin with him. This is Shuttle Launch Control at 1 hour, 58 minutes, 57 seconds in counting. And Dr. Judy Resnick, who was mission specialist for the ST-41D mission on her first flight, is in the white room now preparing to put on her egress harness and get ready for her entrance into the orbiter. On her first flight, 3 satellites were deployed, and she was responsible for operating the remote manipulator arm on that particular flight. She's also responsible for operating the arm for placing the Spartan Halley spacecraft in orbit and then recovering it later in flight. That will be put in orbit over the side on the second day. The orbiter will move about 5 miles away and allow it to function and look at Halley's comet for 40 hours and then go back and pick it up and bring it back to Earth. Her undergraduate degree was from Carnegie Mellon University, and she earned her Ph.D. in electrical engineering from the University of Maryland. Prior to joining NASA in 1978 as a mission specialist, Judy Resnick worked as a senior systems engineer in product development for the Xerox Corporation in California. She's a native of Akron, Ohio, and also a classical pianist, and enjoys flying and bicycling in her spare time. Ellison Onizuka, also in the white room. Actually, everybody's going to be in there shortly as they get ready. The teacher observer, Christa McCauliffe, has been handed an apple by the closeout crew. Ellison Onizuka now getting his egress harness on. The native of Hawaii, is a graduate of Kona Waiina High School and earned both a Bachelor and Master of Science degree in Aerospace Engineering from the University of Colorado. After receiving his commission in the Air Force, he served as a flight test engineer and participated in the flight programs and system safety engineering for a wide variety of aircraft. He graduated from the Air Force Test Pilot School and then served on the staff. Onizuka is one of the astronauts known as the Cape Crusaders, who were assigned to KSC for a period of time of several launches and work with the orbiter test and checkout teams and the launch support crews. The astronaut support person on board, Sonny Billy Bob Carter, is also one of the Cape Crusaders at the present time.
U.S. functional initialization is complete. That's step 405.
405, copy.
We're 1 minute away from picking up the count for the final 9 minutes of the countdown in today's launch. The countdown is simply a series of checks that people go through and preparations to ensure that everything is ready for flight. The countdown for a launch like the 51L mission is four volumes and more than 2,000 pages. 15 seconds away from resuming the countdown and looking at a launch of 51L at 11:38. And we're at T-minus 9 minutes and counting. The ground launch sequencer program has been initiated.
Turn your APU brush recorder.
Sheriff, yes, will do.
And LPS, place all fire room printer plotters online.
LPS, copy.
And ISL, I'll need your verification when you get motion on the aft recorder.
ISL, copy. STM 1015 was not performed.
T-minus 8 minutes, 30 seconds and counting. The flight instrument recorders are turned on. Mission control has turned on the auxiliary data system. This package collects data from the aerodynamic information coming back as the orbiter flies through the atmosphere. Coming up on the 8 minute point. T-minus 8 minutes and counting. Orbiter test conductor Roberta Weirich has requested that Houston send the stored program commands, which is the final update on antenna management based on the liftoff time, and sets the system which makes the orbiter compatible with downrange tracking stations.
Okay, that's complete.
T-minus 7 minutes 30 seconds, and the ground launch sequencer has started retracting the orbiter crew access arm. This is the walkway used by the astronauts to climb in the vehicle, and that arm can be put back in place within about 15 to 20 seconds if an emergency should arise. Coming up on the 7-minute point in the countdown. T-minus 7 minutes and counting. The next major step will be when pilot Mike Smith is given a go to perform the auxiliary power unit pre-start. T-minus 6 minutes, 30 seconds and counting.
KRPS, start your dial and flash recorders.
Roger, will come.
Coming up on the 6-minute point in our countdown. T-minus 6 minutes, and orbiter test conductor has given pilot Mike Smith a go to perform the auxiliary power unit pre-start. Mike has reported back that it's in work. He will configure switches in the cockpit to put the auxiliary power units in the ready-to-start configuration. Mike Smith reporting that pre-start is complete. T-minus 5 minutes, 30 seconds and counting, and Mission Control has transmitted the signal to start the onboard flight recorders. The two recorders will collect measurements of shuttle system performance during flight to be played back after the mission. Coming up on the 5-minute point, this is a major milestone where we go for auxiliary power unit start. T-minus 5 minutes.
Let's go for orbiter APU start.
TLP. OTT, perform APU start.
And we've had the pilot ordered to perform the APU restart. LOX replenish has been terminated and liquid oxygen drain back has been initiated. Pilot Mike Smith now flipping the three switches in the cockpit to start each of the three auxiliary power units. T-minus 4 minutes, 30 seconds and counting. The solid rocket booster and external safe and arm devices have been armed. We've had a report back from Mike Smith that we have three good auxiliary power units. Main fuel valve heaters on the three shuttle main engines have been turned on in preparation for engine start. T-minus 4 minutes and counting. The flight crew has been reminded to close their airtight visors and their launch and entry helmets, and a final purge sequence of the main engines is underway. T-minus 3 minutes, 45 seconds and counting. The orbiter aerosurface test has started. The orbiter flight control surfaces are now being moved through a pre-programmed pattern to verify that they are ready for launch. T-minus 3 minutes, 30 seconds and counting. Orbiter ground support equipment power bus has been turned off, and the vehicle is now on internal power. T-minus 3 minutes, 15 seconds. Aerosurface checks are complete, and aerosurfaces in launch configuration. Gimbal checks of the orbiter's main engines now underway. T-minus 3 minutes and counting. Gimbal checks now complete. External tank liquid oxygen pressurization has started, and purging of the shuttle main engines is terminated. T-minus 2 minutes, 44 seconds in counting. Retraction has started of the gaseous oxygen vent hood. And the ground launch sequencer will make a final check to make sure the vent arm is fully retracted at T-minus 37 seconds.
OTC PLT, caution warning, memories cleared, no unexpected errors.
Copy.
T-minus 2 minutes and 20 seconds, and we've had the pilot, Mike Smith, has cleared the caution and memory system. No unexpected errors reported. Liquid oxygen ullage pressure checks are underway, and the liquid oxygen tank approaching flight pressure. T-minus 2 minutes in counting. The liquid hydrogen replenish has been terminated, and liquid hydrogen pressurization to flight level is underway. The vehicle is now isolated from all ground propellant and fluid loading equipment. T-minus 1 minute, 44 seconds in counting. coming up on the 92nd point in our countdown. 90 seconds in counting. The 51L mission ready to go. The liquid hydrogen tank now at flight pressure and all three engines ready to go. Coming up on the 1 minute point in our countdown. T-minus 1 minute and counting. Sound suppression water system now armed. The hydrogen burn igniters have been armed. These igniters will be fired at T-minus 10 seconds to burn off any residual hydrogen gas. T-minus 45 seconds in counting. The solid rocket booster flight instrumentation recorders have gone into the record mode. Coming up on the 32nd point in our countdown. T-minus 30 seconds, and we've had a go for auto-sequence start. The SRB hydraulic power units have started. T-minus 21 seconds, and the solid rocket booster engine gimbal now underway. T-minus 15 seconds. T-minus 10, 9, 8, 7, 6. We have main engine start. 4, 3, 2, 1, and liftoff. Liftoff of the 25th Space Shuttle mission, and it has cleared the tower.
Roger, roll, Challenger. Good roll program confirmed. Challenger now heading downrange. Engines beginning throttling down now at 94%. Normal throttles for most of the flight, 104%. We'll throttle down to 65% shortly. Engines at 65%, three engines running normally, three good fuel cells, three good APUs. Velocity 2,257 feet per second. Altitude 4.3 nautical miles. Downrange distance 3 nautical miles. Engines throttling up. Three engines now at 104%.
Challenger, go at throttle up.
Challenger, go at throttle up.
Minute 15 seconds. Velocity 2,900 feet per second. Altitude 9 nautical miles. Downrange distance 7 nautical miles.
Fido trajectory. Go ahead. Trajectory, Fido. Flight Fido, Sutter's got disconnect sources. Here we go.
Flight GC, we've had negative contact, lost downlink.
Okay, all operators, watch your data carefully. Flight Fido, until we get stuff back, you don't have cue cards for the board modes.
Procedures, any help?
Negative, Fido, no data.
Flight controllers here looking very carefully at the situation. Obviously a major malfunction.
Negative downlink.
Copy.
We have no downlink.
Flight Fido, go ahead. RSO report the vehicle exploded.
We have a report from the flight dynamics officer that the vehicle has exploded. Flight director confirms that. We are looking at checking with the recovery forces to see what can be done at this point.
All operators, contingency procedures in effect.
Contingency procedures are in effect. We will report more as we have information available. Again, to repeat, we have a report relayed through the flight dynamics officer that the vehicle has exploded. We are now looking at all the contingency operations and awaiting word from any recovery forces in the downrange field. This is Mission Control Houston. We have no additional word at this time. Reports from the flight dynamics officer indicate that the vehicle apparently exploded and that impact in the water at a point approximately 28.64 degrees north, 80.28 degrees west. We are awaiting clarification from as to the location of the recovery forces in the field to see what may be possible at this point. And we will keep you advised as further information becomes available. This is Mission Control.
Advised as details become available to us. This is Mission Control, Houston.